We're now joined by Carlo Asuncion, Chief Economist of Unionbank's Corporate Planning Group. Carlo, thank you so much for joining us. Good morning.
Good morning. Thank you for having me.
Okay, so Carlo, how do you make sense of the diverging outlook calls on the Philippine economy recovery story? Moody's Analytics saying things are looking up as long as government doesn't reopen too quickly. But you've got Fitch Ratings, on the other hand, revising our outlook from triple B stable to negative. Where are you leaning more towards?
Yeah, well, in fact, I think Moody's was had a U-turn last Tuesday also. Yeah, we mentioned about looking up, but they also mentioned about the Philippines being a laggard and the most sluggish. And I think also mentioning the only modest fiscal spending. And I think trying to put these things together, I think one thing that has to be really clear with all of these things is that all of these, multilaterals and anything outside of us or outside of the Philippine government, they've just been really pointing out on having a sufficient fiscal stimulus. So I wasn't able to actually send the chart, but I was looking at the performance of the ASEAN five, the five countries in 2020 in terms of their GDP growth, and the amount of fiscal stimulus that they actually put out, and it was well. If you just look at it, eyeball it, simple looking at it, you see that there seems to be a correlation between the amount of what was spent and the economic growth that was attained during 2020. And unfortunately, the Philippines had one of the most deepest, in fact, the deepest among the five in 2020. And then looking at the first quarter. So if you're going to all sum it up with all of these downgrades, they're all mentioning about this, about how much are we spending. It's not even the stimulus. I think it's really about also if the spending is actually happening. And we know that in June 30, Bayanihan 2 actually expired. So, but we'd still like 64 billion left that will return to, of course, the Bureau of Treasury. But that's something that has to be really clear and has to be looked at very carefully moving forward.
Mm-hmm. But Carlo, I think it's for our economic managers, it seems like it's a chicken and egg question, because the reason why we didn't spend so much or allocate too much is that this government is worried that if we take on too much debt, it could hurt GDP, debt to GDP ratio, and could cause a downgrade. But here we are, these ratings agencies saying, No, but you're not spending enough. So should we have spent more, you think, and how much more? I mean, when you compare the ASEAN five, how big is the discrepancy or the gap of spending that we did versus what our peers did?
Malaysia did a lot. No, Singapore, of course, did significantly as well. Philippines is it's really down there. To your point of should we have done more? Well, tapos na. So I think that moving forward now, and I think a lot of think tanks are saying that we should actually, start spending. And IMF actually did give a good point about, steadfast execution of the budget. I think at this point, that is really the thing that we can really do, and make sure that the spending of the budget is in line. And once Congress comes back and probably deal with the Bayanihan 2 or probably come up with the Bayanihan 3, those are the things that has to be, put forward.
Mm-hmm. Carlo, a lot of these are really still centered around the pandemic. How do you factor in the emerging COVID-19 variants? We have Delta, Delta Plus, we've got Lambda. You've got gamma. I mean, what are your best case, base case, and worst case scenarios?
Well, I just look at what's been happening around us. I think we made mention about, you were talking about Malaysia right now grappling with the Delta variant.
Yesterday, Malaysia reported 11,079 new cases.
Yes.
And if I could share, Indonesia reported 47,899 new cases for just yesterday.
I don't know if you heard about the news of 200 medical workers or people that were actually doing the vaccination that were infected. And about, I think, 2,000 plus people were there during those days. And so that could really be a super spreader event right there. And supposedly, it's supposedly be, you know, something to control the pandemic or to control the spread. But instead, it's because of the variant that is more, you know, contagious. So looking at that, hopefully it doesn't, you know, come to our shores and come to that point that some of our neighbors are grappling with right now. Because there's just one thing to do if these things happen. You have to lock down again. So you're going to be doing another, you know, what we did last end March. And then practically up until May, where we've been closed, very closed. No? I mean, the stringent lockdown. So I think that would not bode well for recovery prospects, you know, in this second quarter, in the second half, because we're really looking at the second half as when, you know, when vaccinations ramp up, the supply of vaccines rises. That's we were, you know, looking at second quarter, second half as a better economic growth prospects for the Philippines with vaccination efforts rising.
But with what's happening to our neighbors, they're very close to us. Indonesia, Malaysia, Singapore, Japan is also under a state of emergency. Should this be a warning that maybe second half is not going to be as rosy or as smooth sailing as we all hoped or initially priced in?
Well, I would say yes. Yes, it's a warning. And at the same time, you know, it's also something to learn from and learn from right away and be wary and be, you know, stringent about it now moving forward. And I think we could never take down our guards. And now that we know, you know, that what do you call this, the positivity rate, or at least the some of the cases, at least in the NCR, has been going down. So we should not sleep on it and be, you know, be confident about it. And, you know, this may actually blow up in our faces.
Let's talk about the outlook for the second half. Socioeconomic Planning Secretary Carl Chua, who, by the way, is celebrating his birthday today. Happy birthday, Secretary.
Happy birthday,
you still owe us an interview. he said a couple weeks back how an above 10% GDP growth for the second quarter for the April to June period is very doable for Q2. Would you agree? And what is your call for the second half of the year?
Well, for let me just deal with the second quarter. We're looking at 8.1. We're also doing well. We think that it's actually very low because some of the others are actually having double digit calls. We're doing a semi semi real time tracking nowcasting, and the nowcast last June was at 6.3, still at 6.3. So once the new data come in, and we'll see where it's at. But we're also looking at other indicators that is saying that it's actually near the double digit. No, so it is possible. It is possible to have a 10% higher growth for second quarter. And for your point of,
But how much of that is low base effect?
Well, it is low base effect.
Just low base effect.
Yes.
Nothing to celebrate about.
Yeah, well, you wanna think that there's more, you know, about it, but it's really because it's like decline of 17% in the second quarter, so that's really deep, and you're looking at just even 10%. In fact, like Singapore is like 14% or even 13%. So I think it's just really low base impact.
And for the rest of the year, what is your GDP call?
Yeah, we're looking at for this year at 4%, 2021. 4%.
Oh. Yeah, so this is pretty conservative.
Yeah, we're actually ADB is 4.5 and everyone else is right up there, but we're 4%. Of course, if things get better, what we're looking at, the vaccinations, you know, the status of the fiscal spending, if it really becomes a very steadfast and a very sure and a significant rollout of the spending, then we might be looking at a different number. No? Also watching out for the new variants, of course, because these are very critical to the forecasts.
We want to end with a peso. What do you make of the weaker peso? Because after crossing that 50 peso to the dollar handle psychological mark, it seems we've been on the weak side ever since. Are we getting weaker? Is the peso getting weaker or is the dollar just getting stronger? And what's your year-end call for the local currency?
Yeah, well, if you noticed last week, if I'm not mistaken, that's when it really started to really weaken, really strong. And it did breach the 50. And then and we were looking at it, and it's much more of really what's been happening outside. You know, and then this week came the negative outlook. Then it was aggravated by that. But we think that it's a knee-jerk reaction. So, we think that it's really much more of what's been happening outside. What's been specifically the talks in the U.S. about the Fed tapering and all those things. Then now the inflation debate, whether it's transitory or not. So it's really that, no, and it's just that this call by the Fitch Ratings that has at least moved it a bit, at least for this week. For our call, we're looking at the 50 above, of course, 50 above. So that's where it is.
Okay. On that note, Carlo, always appreciate your insights. Thank you so much for joining us. I know you're very busy, but I hope you can join us soon again.
Thank you.